So today we'll start with cerebral physiology, okay? So the first thing that we need to know in cerebral physiology, we'll start with is anatomy of cerebral circulation. ठीक है? So what is this that I have drawn over here but I have not labeled? Is this clearly seen?
Circle of Willis.
Yes, this is circle of Willis. Okay. So the circle of Willis is made, it starts, there's the anterior part. Okay. There's anterior and then there's a posterior part. Okay, so here first you'll have what is, these are the vertebral arteries, okay. So there are two paired vertebral arteries. So you have the right and you have the left vertebral artery. These two vertebral arteries will join and form what is the basilar artery. Okay, so the two vertebral arteries and the basilar artery provide the posterior circulation. Okay. From the basilar artery, you will see arises the PCA. What is PCA? Which artery is this?
Posterior
cerebral artery. Okay. Cerebral. So the basilar artery will branch to give two posterior cerebral arteries. Okay. It also gives the SCA. What is SCA? Right anterior and left. Cerebral. So this is superior cerebellar artery.
Superior cerebellar
artery. Posterior cerebral artery and this is superior cerebellar. So cerebellar artery is superior and inferior. Superior means there's only one pair, right and left. In inferior, you have got anterior inferior cerebellar artery and posterior inferior cerebellar artery. So this is anterior inferior cerebellar artery, AICA. Okay, right and left. Okay, and you have the, and over here you have, which I have not drawn. I just put it. Here you have the posterior inferior
cerebellar artery.
Okay, so this is the PICA. Right? And left. So you got the anterior inferior cerebellar artery, posterior inferior cerebellar artery. Anterior inferior is arising from basilar arteries after both the vertebral arteries have joined. But posterior inferior cerebellar arteries are arising from the right vertebral artery, from the respective vertebral arteries. Okay, and here in the center you have the spinal, anterior spinal artery. Okay, so this is the anterior spinal artery over here. Okay, between the two vertebral arteries. So this all is forming the posterior circulation. Okay, then ahead, upper, what do we have here? This is the anterior circulation.
Anterior circulation.
Okay, so if I label this as ICA, right ICA, left ICA, what does that mean?
Internal carotid artery.
Yes. So internal carotid artery, the right and the left internal carotid artery will give rise to the right MCA and left MCA. It also gives rise to the ACA. What is all this?
Communicating artery, anterior communicating artery, middle.
Is this communicating with something or is it not? And what is this then? ACOM.
Oh, this is artery, cerebral artery, and that is communicating artery.
So now tell me again, what is what? So this internal carotid artery is giving rise to ACA. What is ACA?
Anterior cerebral artery.
Yes, and it's giving rise to the MCA.
Middle cerebral artery. Middle cerebral artery.
Two anterior cerebral arteries are communicated with the help of
anterior communicating artery.
Communicating artery.
Yes. And here the posterior communicating artery posterior is going to be between the MCA and the PCA. Between the middle cerebral artery and posterior cerebral artery. Is this clear or is there any confusion in this? Clear, what is connecting with what and where is what arising from? Okay, so the right and the left internal carotid arteries will give rise to this anterior circulation. The left, right and the left vertebral arteries will give rise to the posterior circulation. Okay, and the right, now what is forming the circle of Willis? So the internal carotid artery, both right and left, and the basilar artery, right? Basilar artery is giving rise to here, correct? So this is the circle of Willis. And it is, it's originating means the source of blood supply of this circle of Willis comes from basilar artery and the two internal carotid arteries. Okay. Now, this circle of Willis, which is there, there is collateral circulation. What does that mean? Circulation between the right and the left is possible. Okay. As well as anterior-posterior circulation also is possible. But that does not occur in normal circumstances. Okay. Under normal circumstances, it does not occur because the pressures are the same. Right and left pressures are the same. Anterior-posterior pressures are the same. But in case if there is a blockage in any of these branches over here, that is the time the collaterals will actually start occurring. Okay, that is the time the collateral flow will occur in attempt to perfuse the region whose perfusion has been affected. Okay, now what we have to understand is venous drainage. All right, so I'll make the board horizontal. So the venous drainage, there are going to be superficial, you have the superficial cortical veins and you have the deep cortical veins. Is it, I'm visible and this is clear, right? So the blood drainage, the venous drainage, okay. So venous drainage will occur from the superficial cortical veins and the deep cortical veins, all right. So these two will now come and drain into what? The dural sinuses, okay? The dural venous sinuses. All right. Now, which are these dural venous sinuses? So you have the superior and inferior sagittal sinus. Okay. Then you have the straight sinus. You have the transverse sinus. And then you have the sigmoid sinus. Sigmoid sinus. Okay. So the blood flow will start from the venous flow will start from the two cortical veins, superficial deep, empty into the dural venous sinuses, these four. And ultimately it will drain out from the head into what?
Jugular vein.
Yes. So the right and left IJV. All right. So this is the venous drainage for the cerebral circulation. It's very simple, very straightforward, no confusion. So everyone's okay with this? Then we'll move forward. Okay. Okay.
Amen.
So now we need to know there are some normal values, okay? There are some normal cerebral physiological values that we want to know. For example, what is the weight of the brain? What is the cerebral blood flow? Normal cerebral blood flow. How much cardiac output reaches the brain? How much is the oxygen consumption by the brain? So all these are normal values that we should know. What is a normal intracranial pressure? All right. So we'll start with, I'll just put those values down and then you can keep those in mind. All right. So the normal cerebral physiological values. Okay. What are they? So first we want to know what is the weight of the brain. Anyone wants to guess?
1.1.
What is the weight of the brain?
1.4.
Yes. So both of you are right. It is 1350 grams. And these values which I'm giving you, they're all from Miller's. They're all mentioned in Miller's. Okay. So the weight of the brain is 1350 grams. Okay. How much cardiac output does the brain receive? So it receives
20%.
Yeah. 15%. Yes. 15% of the cardiac output goes to the brain. Okay. How much is the cerebral blood flow? So CBF, CBF is cerebral blood flow. Okay. So there is, now there are three cerebral blood flows that we need to know. Okay. So one is the global. Okay. One is the, how much is happening in the gray matter? And we need to know the white matter. Okay. So, cerebral blood flow, there are three cerebral blood flow values that we need to know. Out of which gray matter, which I mean to say is cortical. Gray matter means cortical blood flow. White matter means subcortical. Okay. So, how much is the cerebral blood flow overall? Any guesses? Global. Anyone wants to guess? So, I'll tell you. So, it is 50 ml per 100 grams of brain per minute. Okay. It's visible, right? Okay. 50 ml. So, whenever we discuss supply to the brain, blood supply, it's always expressed as ml per 100 gram of brain tissue per minute. If we are going to discuss about oxygen supply to the brain, it's going to be ml per 100 gram per minute. That is the way it is denoted. Okay. So 50 ml of blood supply occurs to 100 gram of brain tissue per minute. Okay. That is for the overall brain supply, cortical plus subcortical. Now, if I tell you that the cortical blood supply of the gray matter is actually more than the global blood supply. This will sound a little controversial to you. Okay, how is it possible? But the value is 75 to 80 ml per 100 gram per minute. Okay. And the subcortical, which is white matter, has very less blood supply, which is 20 ml per 100 gram of white matter tissue per minute. Okay, so it is how much? The whole global cerebral blood flow is 50 ml per 100 gram per minute. The gray matter, which is a cortical, that why is now this cortical? Now you can see cortical is having almost 80 ml. Per 100 grams per minute, and subcortical white matter has only 20 ml blood supply, okay, per minute. So you will say that overall blood supply of the brain is 50. How is it that this is having more and this is having less, but yet the you might feel I should just add these two and get this answer, right?
Average of this two is 50 ml.
Exactly. So why? This is not a simple mathematical average. That if somebody is having 80 apples and another person is having 20 apples and they're living in the same house, so how many apples are there in that house? It's not as simple as that. Like if you tell, okay, gray matter has 80 apples, white matter has 20 apples, both are living in the one brain tissue. Let's do 80 plus 20 divided by 250. So the reasoning behind this is that the gray matter is much more active, okay, than the white matter. The amount of energy needed by the gray matter to do its activities is much more, okay. So there's a very, very important statement which is given in Miller's. All right. When you read through it, you will find it. The cerebral blood flow and the cerebral metabolic rate of the gray matter, which is the cortex, is four times more that of the white matter. This is straight direct from Miller's that I'm telling you. Okay, the blood flow and metabolism is four times more in gray matter than the white matter. Hence, the blood supply in a gray matter is more. And hence, the overall, when you will compare the gray matter blood supply, the gray matter metabolism is much more than the overall global metabolism. Okay, So now, if you want to understand that how come we are getting these values, I can explain that to you in short. It's a simple mathematical thing. But first I'll explain the other normal values and then I'll explain to you how we get this answer 18, how we get this answer 20. Okay. So first now we understand what is a cerebral CMRO2. Anybody wants to tell me what a CMRO2 meaning stand for?
Cerebral metabolic requirement of oxygen.
Yeah, so it is the amount of oxygen that is required for cerebral metabolism. Okay, so this value is 3.5. Now what I'm telling, this is at rest. At rest, and this is for the global. I'm talking here for the whole brain. Okay, It is 3.5, same denotation, ml per 100 gram per minute. Okay. So CmRO2 normal value is 3.5 ml per 100 grams per minute. Okay. What is the normal intracranial pressure in supine position, normal ICP in supine? It is 8 to 12 millimeters of mercury. Okay. So the normal intracranial pressure is 8 to 12 millimeters of mercury. The normal oxygen that is required by the brain at rest is 3.5 ml per 100 gram of brain tissue per minute. Okay. So these values are understood and registered in your brain now?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So now, this, now I'll explain to you how much energy does the brain consume and where does it actually use this energy? All right. So if there's a whole brain tissue, 100% of the brain, okay. So if there is, like if you consider this much 100% of the energy which is there, 60% of this energy and 40% of the energy is used for different functions of the brain. Okay, so 60% of all energy consumption of the brain is for maintaining electrophysiological, for its electrophysiological function, which means what? For like message, passing on the messages, for nerve conduction, for that. So for the functional component of the brain, for the brain to perform its normal functions of transmission of impulses, 60% of the energy is used. Okay, so 60% is for maintaining electrophysiological function of the brain. Okay. Now, what is the remaining 40% used for? Any guesses? The remaining 40% is used for maintaining cellular integrity of the brain. Okay. So that means what? The brain is made up of cells, right? Neurons. To maintain their structural homeostasis, to maintain their cellular homeostasis, they also require some energy to maintain themselves. All right. So the remaining 40% is devoted towards cellular homeostasis. So for understanding purpose, you have to remember 60% of the energy goes towards maintaining the functional component of the brain, and the remaining 40% is going towards the cellular activity of the brain. Okay. So is this much clear, this much part? Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. Are you interested in knowing ke wo, how do you get 80 and 20, or you want me to take that later? Okay, fine. Let's just do it fata, quickly, okay? So, as you know, what is the cortical, what is the cerebral blood flow in the cortex? It is four times that. Cerebral blood flow, the normal value is 50, right? This is normal. I'm not putting the units. Okay. We know cortical cerebral blood flow is four times that of the subcortical, right? Gray matter blood flow is four times that of, oh God, again, this is, so the gray matter, the blood flow is four times that of the white. So if you take the white matter as X, blood flow over there is X, then the blood flow here is four times X. So yes. If you take 4X plus X, upon 2, because of these 2 units, that will give you 50. Okay. So if you do this, 5x upon 2 is equal to 50. What will you get this as? You have to find the value of x, right? So that will give you 100 upon 5, which is 20. Therefore, the flow here is 20 ml. Okay, and the flow here is 4 times 20, which is 80. From that statement of Miller's, what Miller said, it is 4 times more. So applying simple mathematics here to that statement, okay, so we get this. So similarly, even for the oxygenation, if you compare it in a similar way, if you say cerebral, how much is the oxygen requirement overall? So if you say the overall CMRO2 is 3.5, correct? 3.5 ml. So the cortical CMRO2 is 4 times that of the subcortical. Okay. So again, this is 4x and this is x. So you get 5x upon 2 is equal to 3.5. So what's the value of x? 7 by 5, which is almost giving you 1.4, I guess. It gives 1.4, correct. So if you multiply, so the value over here is 1.4. This value is not given in millers. But when you will see, it's there in one of the graphs. And 4 times this, so 4 times into 1.4, we give you 5.6. So the oxygen requirement in the cortex is almost, in the normal person, is almost 5.6. Okay, ml per 100 grams of brain tissue per minute, and the subcortical area, which is the white area, requires 1.4 ml of oxygen per 100 grams of brain tissue per minute. Remember this, we will be doing one graph based on this value. All right. Now let's move forward. And let's understand what are the factors which are influencing the cerebral blood flow. Okay. Okay. So there are some factors. Can I use a short form now? You all are comfortable with this?
Yes, ma'am.
Factors which are influencing cerebral blood flow. So anybody wants to give any guesses as to what could be the possible factors? Any guesses?
Blood pressure. Any arterial BP.
Anything else?
Intracranial pressure.
Intracranial pressure.
Yes.
Then position of the patient.
Okay, so now we'll start. All right. So the first, now this is based on the table from Miller's, and I'll explain to you each and every point which are affecting the blood flow, okay, which is affecting the cerebral blood flow. So in Miller's note, they have given it in the form of 4 different categories. All right. So the first category, what they have labeled it as, chemical, metabolic and humoral. No need to be afraid by this such a big subheading. Okay, so the first factor is this, chemical, metabolic and humoral. Now we have to mainly understand what does this include within it. That is important for us. Okay, if you might forget this name, it's okay, but remember what it contains. Okay, so the first is the CMR. Cerebral, metabolic rate. The first factor which is affecting is the cerebral metabolic rate. Within the cerebral metabolic rate, you will have, what will affect the cerebral metabolic rate? You just can't say cerebral metabolic rate. So there is the anesthetic drugs. So under this, you have the anesthetic drugs. Then we have the temperature of the patient. And then what we have is the either arousal, seizures, sleep, or coma. Okay, so this is the first in this. The second which is affecting is the PACO2. Within 10 minutes, the meeting will end and rejoin on the same link. Okay. PACO2, which means arterial, the carbon dioxide, partial pressure of carbon dioxide in arterial blood. The third factor which is affecting, PAO2. Okay. The oxygen content of the arterial blood. The fourth is certain drugs. Certain drugs will affect the cerebral blood flow. Okay. So what are they? Again, we have anesthetic drugs. Then what we have is some vasodilators. And then you have some vasoconstricting agents, okay? So these actually are the main factors which are affecting the cerebral blood flow. Apart from this, then we have got myogenic, rheologic and neurogenic, which I'll explain after we go through each of these, then we go forward to that. Okay, so first we have to understand what is this, the first factor, cerebral metabolic rate. So now we'll understand how cerebral metabolic rate is affecting cerebral blood flow. Okay. Okay. So there is something called as flow metabolism coupling. Okay, there is a concept called flow metabolism coupling that has a role to play in the cerebral metabolic rate. So now we are understanding cerebral metabolic rate, how cerebral metabolic rate increases and blood flow increases. Obviously, if this metabolism is more in a particular part of your body, the blood flow to that part of your body will increase. If you're exercising, metabolism in your muscles has increased, your blood flow to your muscles will increase. Same to same. That is what our body is, has got this physiological capacity. All right. So we'll understand what is flow metabolism coupling. Now in this, what happens is that when there's increase in the nerve activity in the brain, what will you expect? Metabolism has increased. There's increase in the cerebral metabolic rate. Correct? Nerve function has increased. Metabolism has increased. Metabolism and increase, what will happen? There's increased demand for energy. Okay. We need more energy. From how will that energy be provided? By increasing the cerebral blood flow. This is flow metabolism coupling. Very simple. Increase requirement, therefore blood flow is increasing. Okay. Now, what is signaling this blood flow to increase? We have to understand what are those signals, okay, which are causing the blood flow to increase. So, what are those signals in the flow metabolism coupling? Now, we know there's increase in the nerve activity. That is one thing we understood. Nerve activity has increased. When nerve activity increases, it causes the local release of glutamate. You know glutamate, right? Neurotransmitter. Glutamate is released. Okay. This glutamate release is responsible for synthesis and release of vasodilator nitric oxide. Nitric oxide will cause what? Vasodilatation and increase in the cerebral blood flow. Is this flow understood? Is this reasoning understood? Okay. So this is one method by which the blood flow will increase. When brain activity increases, one of the methods of increasing the blood flow is by release of glutamate and therefore release of nitric oxide, which will increase the cerebral blood flow. Now, what is the second cause for this cerebral vasodilatation to occur? One was glutamate. Now, second, you know oxygen is consumed. Nerve activity has increased, brain metabolism has increased, oxygen consumption has increased. Therefore, locally, there is a decrease in the oxygen. Locally, oxygen is consumed. So, therefore, locally, oxygen supply will be less now. Correct? If you have utilized the oxygen that is available in that particular part of the brain, the local availability has become less. This causes release of a mediator called adenosine. This causes the release of local release of adenosine. And this causes increase in the cerebral blood flow in an attempt to keep the oxygen supply constant. Okay? So adenosine will cause vasodilatation, increase the cerebral blood flow. Is this second method understood?
Yes.
Yes? Okay. Now the third cause. Why is the vasodilatation occurring? Now there is increased metabolism. We know that. In metabolism, there is a release of local byproducts. What are the byproducts usually released in the time of metabolism? Any guesses? So there's increase in the local H plus ions. There's increase in the local K plus ions. There is increase in the local lactate. Okay? There is increase in the local adenosine. All of these will cause vasodilatation and increase the cerebral blood flow. Is this understood?
Yes, ma'am.
So there are three signaling pathways in the flow metabolism coupling. Flow metabolism coupling, as we understood, increase in cerebral metabolic rate will increase the blood flow. Why is this blood flow increasing? Because of local release of adenosine. Okay. Then there is release of glutamate, which causes nitric oxide release, which causes vasodilatation. There are local mediators that are released due to metabolism, such as H plus ions, K plus ions, lactate. All of these are responsible for vasodilation. So all these three factors are responsible for vasodilation. Okay, so what you need to remember in flow metabolism coupling is increased metabolism, increased metabolic rate will have three different pathways through which it causes vasodilation and increase in the cerebral blood flow. Any confusion in this, or can we move ahead?
It's clear,
no? Okay. So now, what we had seen here, in this cerebral metabolic rate, now we know that there is one factor which is flow metabolism coupling and how it works. Okay. So what we have discussed is right now, this: if there is increased brain activity, for example, if there is arousal, patient is awake, if patient is convulsing, brain activity has increased all of a sudden. So metabolism has increased. And therefore, flow metabolism coupling will happen, which I just explained, and that will increase the cerebral blood flow. Okay. If the patient is asleep, if the patient is comatose, okay, so that means the EEG, the conduction, the activity of the brain has depressed. So less activity of the brain, the metabolism has decreased, and therefore cerebral blood flow also has decreased. Okay, now we have to understand anesthetic drugs and temperature, how these are affecting the cerebral blood flow. Okay. So all anesthetic drugs, okay, all anesthetic drugs decrease the cerebral metabolic rate. And therefore, decrease the cerebral blood flow. Okay. Except which two? Any guesses? One is inhalation and one is IV drug. Yes. And nitrous. All anesthetic drugs decrease the cerebral metabolism and therefore decrease the cerebral blood flow. All right, except ketamine and nitrous. Now we will understand that how this reduction occurs. So there is one figure in Miller's. Do you have your Miller's with you? In the meantime, just look at if you have your Miller's in front of you. There is one diagram that I'm going to explain, which is located on my page, is 391. It's figure 17.3, this one. I shall be explaining this right now, the effect of temperature, or the effect of anesthetic drugs, sorry, on cerebral metabolic rate. So we'll try to understand with the help of this figure. Okay. Is this visible, the graph?
Yes.
Yes, okay. So now we'll try to understand what is this graph. Okay, so in the vertical axis, I have wrote it down cerebral metabolic rate, CMR. You're able to see the CMR, cerebral metabolic rate?
Yes.
Yes, and on the horizontal axis over here, we have the cumulative barbiturate dose. Okay, so they did a study and they used barbiturate drugs, okay, such as thiopentone. So what they did was, as they kept on increasing, so in this graph, what we need to understand is, as the anesthetic drug concentration kept on increasing, they saw the EEG response in the person, okay? So the EEG will tell you about the electrical activity of the brain, right? So in this EEG, when the dose was the least, when the barbiturate dose was the least, and almost zero, that is the time the cerebral metabolic rate was at the normal level, okay, the normal awake cell, in an awake person, the cerebral metabolic rate was the maximum, what it usually is, and the patient was having an EEG where it showed that he was awake. Okay, as they increased the dose, they noted that the EEG has started slowing down. You can notice this, as the dose increased, there was slowing of the EEG. After that, there was early burst suppression. So in case there is some burst of activity that was getting suppressed, bursts of activities were getting completely suppressed in the EEG as the dose increased. And then at one point, there was complete suppression, EEG silence. That means there was no activity noted on the EEG. Patient was completely deep under anesthesia as the barbiturate dose was increased. But what they noticed was the cerebral metabolic rate had reduced from 100%. It came down only to 40%. All right. This reduced only till this much. It was not reducing further lower down. So why that further lower down reduction is not occurring with anesthetic drugs? So this, as I told you, that among the whole 100% of the energy of the brain, 60% is going to be used for its functional component, which is transmission of impulses. So as the impulse transmission has become zero, this 60% of the energy requirement has reduced. There has been a 60% reduction in the energy requirement because we have now eliminated this, right? By causing EEG silence. So over here at this point, the functional component of brain functions have stopped, right? Now transmission has stopped. But this remaining 40%, as I told you, is required for maintaining cellular homeostasis, for maintaining cellular function, right? The basic neurons, glial cells, to maintain their structure and function, they need some energy. So that energy requirement cannot be suppressed with anesthetic drugs. No matter how much deep you take the patient, you cannot suppress the basal metabolism that is happening in the cell itself. Is that understood? So hence, we are not able to reduce it further. You see, in this graph, we are not able to reduce it any further. Is this understood, or you are having some confusion in this graph?
Understood.
right? So this this much amount is required for maintaining cellular integrity, which we cannot reduce with the help of anesthetic agents. But when we cause hypothermia, we are able to bring a further reduction in the cerebral metabolism. Okay, here we were able to bring only 60% maximum reduction in cellular metabolism. But when we cause hypothermia, when we induce hypothermia in a patient, we can further reduce the cerebral metabolism. All right. So we'll understand how. So for that, there's another graph that we'll understand. But before that, some things. So cerebral metabolic CMRO2, familiar with this short form? Yes, CMRO2 decreases by 6 to 7% for every 1 degree Celsius reduction, decrease in temperature. And I mean body temperature. Any confusion in this statement?
No.
Okay, so hypothermia, just like anesthetic drugs, even hypothermia can bring complete electrical silence in the EEG. You can get a completely flat EEG. Okay, when you bring the temperature to almost body temperature to 18 degrees, 20 degrees, when you induce hypothermia, that is at this degree, at 18 to 20 degrees Celsius, you can bring complete silence in the EEG. Okay, there's going to be no transmission of impulses. Okay, but if you further decrease the temperature below 18 degrees, you can now reduce the metabolism that happens because of that is required for the maintaining the cellular integrity. What I'm trying to say is that when you bring hypothermia at 18 to 20 degrees Celsius hypothermia, there'll be complete stoppage of the nerve impulse transmission. But if I reduce the body temperature to less than 18 degrees Celsius, now I can slow down the metabolism that is happening at the cellular level.
Okay.
Okay. I shall explain this with the help of a diagram. So now this is again a figure from Miller's. And the figure is this one. So when you read your Miller's, you can refer to this. I'll draw it right now. So is this diagram clearly visible? Now let's understand with the help of this diagram. So in the vertical axis, again, I made a mistake. I've not kept space over here. So this is actually CMRO2. Are you able to read this CMRO2? Is it not visible?
Yes, we can.
You can see. Okay, so this is... Over here on the vertical axis, I am denoting the cortical CMRO2. Okay, this is the cortical. So this is cortical CMRO2. All right. Here is the temperature. So at 37, this is 37 degrees Celsius temperature. This is 27 degrees Celsius temperature. And this is 17 degrees Celsius. So we'll see how hypothermia is going to reduce the function and the metabolism. Okay, the functional and the structural metabolism rate. So at 37 degrees, 60% is going towards the functional work of the brain, correct? 40% of our energy is going towards maintaining the structural integrity at 37 degrees Celsius normal temperature. All right. And over here, almost the requirement of oxygen is 5.5. Is this clear? Then, as hypothermia is induced, we have reduced this by 25% function, 16% for structure. Energy requirement has fallen from 60% to 25%, and energy requirement has fallen from 40% to 16% when hypothermia has been induced, and henceforth, the oxygen requirement also has reduced. The CMRO2 has reduced to 3.5 ml, almost half. From 5.5, the requirement has come to almost 3.5. Okay? Next, if we are going further inducing hypothermia, we have come to 17 degrees Celsius. Here, 0% energy is required for function. Means what? Complete silence of the EEG. Only 8% energy is required for maintaining the structure. So, by this graph, we need to understand, as the temperature of the body is reduced by 10 degrees, further 10 degrees, you can see that there is a significant reduction in the cerebral metabolism. The metabolism by 60%, total metabolism amount has reduced. Your 100%, it was complete, right? Here it has reduced significantly to almost only what, 40%. Only the energy requirement of it was 100% over here, it has reduced to a cumulative 40% energy requirement. This has further reduced to a cumulative only 8% energy requirement. So we have got a gradual decrease in the energy requirement of the brain by decreasing the temperature in the body. The energy requirement that is required for maintaining the functional of the brain, the function, the nerve transmission function, that function has brought come down to zero. Because at such hypothermia, the brain is not transmitting any impulses. So 0% energy is required for functional work of the brain. At the same hypothermia, as I told you, when the body temperature goes below 20 degrees, that is a time when even the cells will require lesser energy to maintain themselves. At the cellular level, the amount of energy spent to maintain the cellular structure and functional integrity, that cellular requirement has reduced to almost 8%. From an awake state, 40% energy is required in a fully awake state by the cells. In a completely hypothermia state, this is at normothermia. Normothermia, it is requiring 40% energy. But when it has come to severe hypothermia of 17 degrees Celsius, the energy requirement by the cells has reduced to 8%.
Okay.
So this is what we have to understand from this graph, that the simple understanding that if I reduce the temperature of the body, the amount of energy required by the brain to carry out its functions will be reduced. And by inducing hypothermia, I am able to reduce the cerebral metabolic rate. By inducing hypothermia, I am able to reduce the cerebral oxygen demand. Therefore, I am able to reduce the cerebral blood flow.
Okay.
If my patient goes in hyperthermia, if his temperature increases, normal body temperature is 37 degrees. If his temperature increases more than 37 degrees, patient goes in hyperthermia. If his body temperature goes up to 42 degrees, so between 37 degrees Celsius to 42 degrees Celsius body temperature, the cerebral metabolic rate will increase, the oxygen demand will increase, and the cerebral blood flow hence will increase. Okay?
Normal CMRO2 is 3.5, no?
Yes. So, you remember we did that
then
formula of X? That was global CMRO2?
For cortical, it's 5.5.
Cortical, it's 5.5.
5.5. 5.5. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Here we are talking about the cortex, because maximum energy requirement is in the cortex. Hence, this diagram has been depicted only with the help of the cortex requirements, not the global. So here we have the cortical oxygen requirement on the vertical axis, and in the horizontal axis, we are having the body temperature.
Okay.
So normal cortical CMRO2 is 5.5. Although global is 3.5, but we know cortical has got 4 times more requirement, 4 times more activity, right?
Yes.
Is this point understood about hyperthermia? That between temperature 37 degrees to 42 degrees, there will be increase in the cerebral blood flow because the demand has increased? Or is there any confusion in this point?
No.
Okay. But now if you increase the temperature, the body temperature of the patient increases further. It goes beyond 42 degrees Celsius. You can imagine 42 degrees Celsius is a very high temperature for the body. So if it goes beyond 42 degrees Celsius, the body temperature, that is a time when you will tell me, ma'am, it will go, as it increases, it will increase. As it is decreasing, it will decrease. It's almost in proportion, right?
Yes.
Increase in temperature means increase in cerebral blood flow. Decrease in temperature means decrease in cerebral blood flow. But when the temperature goes beyond 42 degrees Celsius, that is a time when the proteins in the body, the natural proteins, will start getting destroyed. And that destruction will decrease the cerebral blood flow.
Okay. If it is more than 42 degrees?
Yes. So if body temperature exceeds more than 42 degrees, there will be protein denaturation because of high temperature, and therefore the oxygen requirement and the blood flow will also decrease.
Okay.
So the how temperature is affecting your cerebral blood flow, is this clearly understood? Then we go to how carbon dioxide is going to affect. I'll move ahead.
Denaturation of protein will cause what?
So denaturation of proteins will decrease the overall metabolism, right? Because our structural integrity is only not maintained.
Okay.
If cellular structure is not maintained, the cellular metabolism will decrease.
Okay.
And therefore, the blood flow will decrease.
Mm-hmm.
But that is provided the temperature goes above 42 degrees.
Yes.
So should I move forward to how PaCO2 is affecting?
Yes.
Yes, okay. So what we saw in this, so now we have understood cerebral metabolic rate. We have understood how anesthetic drugs are affecting it, how temperature is affecting, how awake and asleep and comatose patient is affecting, correct? Now we'll understand how PaCO2, the CO2, is going to affect the cerebral blood flow. Okay. So now we are here. So what you need to know is that there is a linear relationship between cerebral blood flow and PaCO2. There is a linear relationship. Okay, between changes in the PaCO2 and change in the cerebral blood flow. What do I mean by linear relationship? It's almost
proportional.
So, increase in the PaCO2, I will expect increase in cerebral blood flow. Correct? And? Mm. In decrease in the PaCO2, I'll expect decrease in the cerebral blood flow. But for this, there is a range. All right. So this direct proportionality, okay, so change in the cerebral blood flow will be directly proportional to change in the partial pressure of the CO2, provided, very important, PaCO2 values are between 20 to 80 millimeter mercury. This is very, very important. So if the PaCO2, for example, has gone from 20 to 40, double, sudden increase in PaCO2 from 20 to 40, blood flow will also increase. It will also double. If PaCO2 falls from 60 to 30, almost half, so fall by 50%. So this also will fall by 50%. But the moment PaCO2 goes less than 20, response will not be seen. Moment PaCO2 goes more than 80, response will not be seen. This will be responding to changes in the PaCO2 provided PaCO2 value is between 20 to 80 in the blood. Don't confuse this with normal PaCO2 value. That is different. That we know what is a normal, right? So within normal range of PaCO2, which is 35 to 45, this also will be normal. But when this will decrease below 35, somewhere it's gone to 22, 25, this also will decrease. Okay. So is this thing understood? Okay, within this range, you will find changes in the cerebral blood flow and that these are directly proportional?
Yes.
Okay, now how much it will change? So how much is the change? So if the change in cerebral blood flow, change I'm saying, means plus or minus. So if the change in PaCO2 will be by 1 millimeter mercury, what I'm saying, PaCO2 increase or decrease by 1 mmHg, this means that the change in the cerebral blood flow will be how much? 1 to 2 ml per 100 grams of brain tissue per minute. Again, very important to remember this. So what I mean to say is that if the PaCO2 increased by 10, from 30 it went to 40. Okay. PaCO2 increased by 10. So at that PaCO2, if his cerebral blood flow was around 50? Normal cerebral blood flow 50? Or 50 it will, if this has become plus 10, so that will also become plus 10. It will become 60. Okay. This nobody is going to ask you in a mathematical question, math exams. You just need to understand this, that when my PaCO2 is between 20 to 80 mmHg, okay, it is this much. That means my blood flow is going to be directly related to this. So if my CO2 is decreasing by 1, that means this will also decrease by 1 ml. If this is increasing by 1 mmHg, this will also increase by 1 ml. It is directly proportional to each other. Okay? So this direct proportionality will come when it will take place when the patient is not under effect of anesthesia. Like me, I'm here, you're there, and maybe we are having suddenly hypercarbia or we are having hypocarbia. So we will respond with this. Our body, our brain will respond like this. Is this understood or confusion?
Understood.
Okay. So under the effect of anesthesia, how things will work. Okay. So if the patient is under anesthesia and there is hypocarbia, what you will expect the blood flow to happen?
Hypocarbia decreasing.
Where will the cerebral blood flow go? Increase or decrease?
Decrease.
Hypocarbia, decrease in PaCO2, hence we expect decrease in the cerebral blood flow. Mm. How much will now? Now the patient is under anesthesia. Okay. Mm. Under anesthesia, if that patient's blood flow, the cerebral blood flow, is already at a lower rate, if the flow is already low, then the intensity by which it will further decrease will be less.
Okay.
Or else what will happen? Ischemia can happen, right? See, I will write it and explain to you. So what I explained now, this was for a person who is not under the effect of anesthesia. Maybe the patient, not under the effect of any anesthetic drugs. Okay. Now, what if a patient is under anesthesia? Okay. You know anesthesia drugs affect the cerebral blood flow. This one point we know. This point we all agree with. Yes? Okay. If the ACO2 falls, we expect decrease in the cerebral blood flow, yes? Yes or no? Any confusion, and please stop me. Don't feel as if you cannot ask. Okay. Decrease in PaCO2, we expect cerebral blood flow to fall. So, but while under anesthesia, okay, if the existing cerebral blood flow is low, then the response to PaCO2 will be less intense. Is this paragraph understood?
Yes.
What I'm trying to say, anesthesia drugs are affecting cerebral blood flow. We all agree. PaCO2 decreases. We expect cerebral blood flow to decrease. Yes, we all agree. Someone's laughing.
Ek minute. From where?
Okay, so if there's a decrease in the PaCO2, that means we expect the cerebral blood flow to decrease. But while under anesthesia, if the patient is under anesthesia, then the existing, and suppose the patient is under anesthesia and currently the blood flow is already low. And now suddenly hypocapnia has occurred. Now all of a sudden CO2 has decreased. As a response, the blood flow also will decrease. But existing flow is already less. So it will decrease. Definitely, yes, it will decrease. But it will decrease with less intensity. Or else the perfusion of the brain will get affected. And vice versa, if patient is under anesthesia and the existing cerebral blood flow is high, the blood flow is quite high, then the response will be more intense, which means what? Now we're talking about decrease in the PaCO2. So if I'm having a patient who's under anesthesia and his cerebral blood flow is currently at a high rate. It's going on at a high rate. And right now, the CO2 has decreased. And as a result, the body will compensate and decrease the cerebral blood flow. Already, the cerebral blood flow is quite high. So, it will decrease it by more intensity. So, increase of decreasing it by, suppose it was supposed to decrease it by 10 ml, it will decrease it by 20 ml. Because already, the existing blood flow is a higher rate. Is this understood?
Definitely.
You'll have to read this once, and I'll explain it again once we move ahead. If you're still confused, I'll explain it further. Okay. Now, why does the change in PaCO2 bring about change in the cerebral blood flow? PaCO2, any changes in the PaCO2 causes a change in the cerebral blood flow. What are the mediators which are causing this change? So the first mediator is going to be because of change in the PaCO2 causes change in pH. It causes change in pH of CSF, blood, okay, and basically in the extracellular compartment. In the extracellular compartment of the brain, the changes in the CO2 will cause changes in the pH. Plus, there is a release of nitric oxide. There is a release of some prostaglandins. So these are the factors, these are the mediators which are causing cerebral vasodilatation or cerebral vasoconstriction in response to the CO2 changes. Okay. Now you will tell me, ma'am, how come PaCO2 is the mainly affecting the cerebral blood flow change? Which means what? I'm seeing changes in the PaCO2, right? Which means it could be either respiratory acidosis or alkalosis, right? Because this is a change in the PaCO2 of the blood, right? So some respiratory component is responsible for causing change. It causes a rapid change, right? It causes a rapid change in the cerebrus, resulting cerebral blood flow. Why does this occur? But metabolic, as we know, metabolic acidosis, alkalosis is related to H plus ions, Y carb ions. So in metabolic conditions, this changes will not be seen. In respiratory conditions, these changes will be seen. Why? The reason is because CO2 rapidly diffuses, right? Across the which membrane? Across which barrier? CO2 has a very fast diffusing property. It quickly diffuses across the blood-brain barrier, causes changes in the CSF pH, and hence it will cause the change in the cerebral blood flow. H plus ions cannot move so fast. Hence, in a metabolic disease, if a patient is having a systemic metabolic problem, metabolic acidosis or alkalosis, this response will not be seen. But if the patient is having a respiratory component, then these changes will be seen because CO2 is moving very fast across the blood-brain barrier. All right.
Okay.
Now we'll understand some clinical implications. Okay. Now you will tell me that suppose we want to decrease the intracranial pressure of the patient. Okay. Suppose the pressure in the cranium has become very high. What are the components inside the skull? You have the brain tissue. You have blood vessels, blood. Then you have the fluid, CSF, right?
Yes.
These three things are there inside the skull. Any change in increase in this will cause increase in the pressure in the brain?
Brain, yes. Mm-hmm.
Yeah? So if there is increase in the blood flow to the brain, the pressure in the brain will increase?
Increase.
Yeah? So what yes, you sir. Will tell, you. I want to decrease the pressure in the brain. Huh? Maybe there's a patient who has come, the patient is having some head injury. You will tell, I want to decrease the pressure in the brain. I will hyperventilate the patient. I will decrease the CO2 and therefore I will decrease the blood flow and therefore I will decrease the pressure. You will think, we will think like this. Huh? We will do washout of CO2. We will decrease the CO2 in the blood. We will decrease the cerebral blood flow and we'll decrease the intracranial pressure. So we'll do hyperventilation for that patient. Correct?
You said, ma'am, for metabolic acidosis, compensatory mechanism will be respiratory, no?
Yeah, so compensatory mechanisms will occur. So in response to compensatory mechanisms, you know that metabolic conditions may when the compensatory mechanisms will occur, this change will occur to that.
That time also. But
any change in CO2 will bring a change in blood flow of the brain. Okay, so suppose right now we are hyperventilating the patient. We have managed to wash out the CO2. By washing out the CO2, what have we induced? An alkalosis?
Yes.
Huh? What does alkalosis mean? We have now increased the pH.
Yes.
We have increased the pH of the extracellular component of the brain, which means what? We have increased the pH of whatever is the non-cellular part, which is blood and CSF.
Blood and CSF, yes.
Okay. And now cerebral blood flow will decrease.
Yes.
Decrease
in the PaCO2 will decrease in the cerebral blood flow.
Cerebral blood, yes.
What is decrease in PaCO2? Alkalosis only, no?
Yes.
Now what happens? This effect of decreased cerebral blood flow, this response that cerebral blood flow to the brain will be reduced, it will be lasting only for 8 to 12 hours, this response. Why is this response not lasting for longer time? Why is the response of decreased cerebral blood flow not lasting for long? Within 12 hours, the cerebral blood flow will go back to its normal perfusion. The normal cerebral blood flow rate will reach. Why is it going back to normal? Because right now what has happened over time because of alkalosis, okay, so local mechanisms, what will happen? The bicarb ion concentration has increased in the CSF because of alkalosis, yes or no?
Yes.
So over time, this bicarb will now start decreasing as a compensation. Alkalosis has happened, right? What will the body try to do? Body will try to, we have induced alkalosis, haven't we? We have done hyperventilation. We have induced alkalosis. Body will try to bring everything to normal range. Body always tries to bring things to normal. So body will say, okay, alkalosis has been induced. I will try to bring some amount of acidosis and try to balance the pH. Okay, so what will the body do? Bicarb ions are there inside in the CSF. It will start throwing it out. It will start removing the bicarb ions. By removing the bicarb ions, what has it able to do? The alkalotic pH has now started returning back to normal. Understood?
Yes.
Alkalosis is going back to normal pH range. From high pH, it's coming towards normal pH. Once normal pH has come, what will happen? Cerebral blood flow also become normal. Okay. So, if you think, I want to reduce the intracranial pressure by hyperventilation, this is not a long-term method of managing. This is not useful for long-term. Over a few hours, you want to manage it. You don't think that you can induce this long-term, 1-2 days, and you can continue like this. No. Body will return everything to normal. Okay. So acutely on the table, on the surgery table, when the case is going on and the surgeon says, oh, it's too tight. It's a very immediate management. Surgeon told you the brain is too tight. I am not having space to operate. You will see, okay, the CO2 has become 45. Let me reduce the CO2. I will reduce the blood flow like that. Okay, you did hyperventilation 10, 15 minutes. You have reduced the cerebral, you will expect cerebral blood flow to reduce. It will reduce. Then surgeon will say, yes, pressure has reduced inside. I can operate now. For those acute scenarios, you can definitely do this. But you cannot do this over a long term. Over long term, you have to find some long term solutions to reduce the intracranial pressure. Okay, just by reducing the blood flow, you cannot manage. So is this point understood? Yeah. Now, another example I'll give you. Suppose there's a patient in the ICU and the patient is on the ventilator. All right. People have not seen, usually it happens. So if the patient is being hyperventilated, maybe the respiratory rate was high. Okay. Patient was getting hyperventilated. Okay. Because of that hyperventilation went on. 1 day, 2 days, he's mechanically ventilated, right? Mechanically ventilated. So he cannot control his own respiratory rate. So mechanical ventilation, hyperventilation has occurred, and over 2 days, hyperventilation was happening and his CO2 has come to 25. Okay, then you go there and then you see the ABG and you say, okay, the PaCO2 has become 25. This is too less. I cannot let it be so low. It should be in the normal range, 35 to 45. Who was hyperventilating the patient, whatever. Okay, then you change the ventilator settings. What you will think, I will change ventilator settings and I will try to bring the CO2 to normal range. Okay, but what has happened right now? That then you will try to bring the respiratory rate in the normal range. You will bring the hyperventilation to normal ventilation range. Your PaCO2 will definitely move from 25 to 30, 35, 40, come in the normal range. Yes? And that is occurring between the range of 20 to 80. If you remember, we are right now in the range of 20 to 80.
Yes.
Now from 25 to 40, I have come. I have jumped almost by 15 mmHg, right? CO2. What will happen? Over time, what has happened? The cerebral blood flow was low. It was going at a low rate without causing ischemia to the brain. Over 2 days, it has been going at a slow rate, provided ischemia is not happening. Those reflexes are still patent in the brain. Now, you have increased by 15. As a rule in the body, as a physiological, what will the body sense? Oh, CO2 has increased from 25 to 30. I have to increase the cerebral blood flow. The brain will think like that only, no? Although we are going to the normal area, normal value of CO2, still the brain is feeling, oh no, it's increasing by 15. I have to also increase the blood flow to 15. Okay. So there will be a sudden increase in the cerebral blood flow. And that will increase your pressure again. So another example, same thing. In the ICU setting, maybe the respiratory rate was less. And the CO2 was going up, up, up. It reached 50. CO2 has reached 50. Nobody was seeing, only the CO2 has gone to 50. Then you come and you see, oh my God, since 24 hours, 48 hours, patient CO2 is on the higher side. You will say, this is too much. You will say, I have to bring this down. I have to bring it to the normal range. So what you will do? You might increase the respiratory rate. You might increase the tidal volume. You will do ventilator settings. And you will bring that 55. You will come down to 30. Now you will be satisfied. Yes, I am in normal range. The blood CO2 is in normal range. What has happened now? There is a risk, okay, that you have jumped down by 15. So over 2 days, the body's mechanisms have compensated to this rise in CO2. Now suddenly you have brought the CO2 down. It will respond as how? Oh my God, CO2 has fallen by 15, 20. I have to reduce the cerebral blood flow. Is a response, right? In the brain. That's a normal physiological response in the brain. So cerebral blood flow will decrease. And as per theory, it is not yet proven. But theoretically, this decrease in cerebral blood flow can cause ischemia. So the message that we have to take from these two examples is that if there is any patient in the ICU who has been chronically hyperventilated, chronically hypoventilated, long-standing 2 days, say he's having alkalosis, since 2 days he's having acidosis, you will try to bring the respiratory rate and the ventilator settings towards the normal. You will try to bring the CO2 towards normal, but you will not do it all of a sudden within an hour or two. Within 1-2 hours, you will not try to bring that CO2 normal. You will gradually do it. If you do it gradually, these risks can be avoided. So is this part understood, that why we should understand how CO2 and cerebral blood flow are related to each other?
Yes.
Okay, any doubts you are having in this?
No.
Okay. No, now, okay. So now I'll just show you a graph. This graph, you will see it in many books. Okay. So there is this graph. All right. And here we have the cerebral blood flow, CBF. Okay. What is this? 2550, 2500 ml per 100 grams per minute. Okay. Here we are noting down some pressures in the horizontal axis. I have noted down some pressures. Right now we have understood CO2, so we will consider this as PaCO2, mmHg. Okay, on this axis I am showing you CO2. What we have learned, what is the range between? The response will be directly proportional to each other between the range of 20 to 80. So where is 20? 20 is here. Okay. Where is 80? So 80 will be somewhere here. I should have put this a little far away to each other so that it can be understood more clearly. Okay. So this is 80, where you will have the maximum. Between 20 mmHg PaCO2 and 80 mmHg PaCO2, it's going to be almost directly proportional to each other. Less than 20, no response. More than 20, no change. PaCO2 goes above more than 80, no change in the blood flow. It falls less than 20, no change in the blood flow. Between 20 to 80, yes, it will be directly proportional. Normal value of blood flow is 50. Don't forget, normal value of global cerebral blood flow is 50 ml. We are talking about global cerebral blood flow. So it is directly proportional between this range. Is this graph understood?
Yes.
Okay. Now we'll understand how O2, how fluctuations in oxygen is going to affect the cerebral blood flow. Okay. So a PaO2 value. PaO2 is between 60 to 300 mmHg. When the PaO2, so what is normal PaO2? Around 100, right? So if there's a patient whose PaO2 has gone more than 100, means what, you're getting some supplemental oxygen, PaO2 has become more. Patient is in hypoxia, PaO2 has become less. So this is the range. Partial pressure of oxygen in blood when it is between 60 to 300, no effect on cerebral blood flow. No effect. Okay. But if it goes less than 60, there will be sudden increase in the blood flow. Logical, no? CO2 is falling, blood flow has to increase. Otherwise, how will the oxygen be delivered, right? Oxygen has fallen down to less than 60 mmHg. Cerebral blood flow will then get a stimulus. That hypoxia will cause a stimulus and increase the cerebral blood flow. So how will we visualize this on this graph? That we will understand. Okay. The same thing, I will denote it in the graphical form. And this graph is very important. It is denoted in many books. Okay. So as I said, when the oxygen is up to 60, so up to 60, this is the normal cerebral blood flow, 50, don't forget this point. So oxygen is around 300. Okay, no change in blood flow, no change in blood flow, no change in blood flow. Oh my God, we have reached the 60 mark. PaO2 has fallen down to almost 60. Immediately, there will be a stimulus to the blood vessels and blood flow will increase. 50, 60, 75, blood flow has increased. Is this understood? Huh? This portion of graph, this blue line of the graph is understood. So this blue line is the PaO2.
X-axis is PaO2 or PaCO2?
So this axis is PaCO2. Also we are PaO2. Why are we denoting all the parameters in one graph? Is because our normal range is lying within this. Right? So if this is, now I will also add in this one more thing, which is blood pressure. So there are going to be three parameters on the x-axis. Okay. When, if I'm talking about CO2, I have to look at the yellow graph. Okay. So as per the yellow graph, my CO2 is okay, 20. If I'm considering this to be the horizontal axis, to be CO2, 20 to 80. 80 is over here, 80 is almost here, right? Direct proportionality. Less than that, no response. More than that, no response. 20 to 80 value we know for CO2. Now, if I am using the same graph for CO2, for O2, oxygen. I am using the same graph for oxygen. What I told you, oxygen from 300 up to 60, no problem, no change in blood flow. Moment it touched 60, sudden increase in the oxygen, sudden increase in the cerebral blood flow because the oxygen demand has become less, the oxygen availability has become less, so the CO blood flow will increase all of a sudden. Basically, we are superimposing three different graphs in one common graph. We are superimposing three graphs. One graph is of CO2, one graph is of oxygen. So this graph is PaCO2.
PaCO2.
Okay. This graph is of oxygen. Why are we able to superimpose? Why are we using a common depiction for this? Because on the horizontal axis, all these pressures are lying within the same range.
Same range.
Is that understood? The range is the same, right? If I'm talking about CO2, I'm able to show. If I consider this to be CO2, all this CO2, so then I can denote 20 and 80 mark. If I want to depict the oxygen, I am able to depict 100 and less than over 60. So don't get confused with the graph. Is this understood? As oxygen decreases in the blood, once the oxygen concentration of the blood reaches 60 mmHg, there will be a stimulus to the blood vessels and the cerebral blood flow will increase. Cerebral blood flow is increased, right? From 50, it has increased up. This is understood, right? So in the, you can draw separate graphs also. You can draw same superimposed graph, nothing like that. Okay. Now we have to understand another factor which is affecting cerebral blood flow, which is known as myogenic autoregulation. Okay. So right now we have covered all these points. I have explained to you CO2, O2. Okay. Now drugs, I will explain to you ahead in a little more detail. Okay. So now we understood these factors. Now what is the other factors which are going to affect? There's going to be myogenic autoregulation. What do you understand by myogenic autoregulation? The response of the smooth muscles of the blood vessels are going to respond. That is myogenic autoregulation. Okay. So this we need to understand. This is going to is responsible. Then what do we have? The neurogenic and rheologic, which I'll explain later. So myogenic autoregulation we'll understand first. What is autoregulation? It is the capacity of cerebral circulation to maintain a constant cerebral blood flow over one of MABP mean BP. This BP. What is the meaning of myogenic autoregulation? It means that the cerebral circulation is going to be protective, right? If there's a patient who's hypertensive, his BP is increasing. So cerebral blood flow will keep increasing or what? No, nah. It will try to auto-regulate. It will try to, if the BP is increasing, it will ensure that the perfusion over here remains in the normal range and does not increase in parallel to the increase in the BP. If somebody's having hypotension, doesn't mean that there will be decreased perfusion in the brain. So this is a protective mechanism of the brain, myogenic autoregulation, wherein the circulation of the brain will be maintained. The cerebral blood flow will be maintained at 50 ml, even if the BP increases or decreases or fluctuates over a particular range. Okay, so that range, this range is between 50 to 150 mmHg. This is an important value that you need to know for normotensive. A person like you and me, or somebody who doesn't have any hypertension problems, if their mean arterial BP, you know, when you take the BP, you get systolic, diastolic, and you remove a mean, which comes in the brackets. Yeah, there's a mean which comes. So that mean BP, if it is between 50 to 150, the cerebral perfusion pressure will still remain constant at the rate of 50 ml. But if this is a protective response, this is some protective mechanism of the cerebral perfusion, the cerebral circulation, to prevent over-perfusion or under-perfusion of the brain. So it is a protective thing. Is this understood?
Yes.
It is protective, right? So otherwise, if this would not exist, it would not exist. And suppose the BP of the patient is mean arterial BP was 100. Suppose it was 100. Then what blood flow would go what from 50 to 100? Wouldn't that cause overperfusion and harm to the brain? So, and suppose the patient's BP is falling, patient is going on hypotension, mean arterial BP has become 60, 50, 40. So does that mean that even brain perfusion will be affected? No. You think these important organs, all important organs have got autoregulation. Even kidney has autoregulation. Those autoregulation is a protective mechanism. Then no matter how much the BP will fluctuate, the perfusion, the safe perfusion of that organ will be maintained. So safe perfusion of our brain will be maintained. Our brain will not go into overperfusion. The brain will not even go to hyperperfusion. Okay. over a BP of 150 to 50 to 150. This is very important. Now, if there's a patient who is hypertensive, for a hypertensive patient, this range is a little more. Okay, it is 75 to 175. So if there is, this is for hypertensive. So if there's somebody who is having hypertension, their brain is, because of the systemic hypertension, there are certain changes that occur because of which the autoregulation range is moved upwards. It goes to 75 to 175. So if there's a hypertensive person who's having high BP and a person with high blood pressure and his mean arterial BP goes to 150 also, his brain will not get overperfused and not go have any problems. It will be undergoing normal perfusion only because this is protective. If there is a normal patient, normal person, okay, and suppose you his BP has increased all of a sudden on the surgical table, you're intubating, an intubation response and BP has increased, mean arterial BP has become 100, 120, yet his brain will be protected from hyperperfusion. So is this thing understood?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Now what happens if, now you should know what happens if this goes less or more. So if the what will happen if it goes less? Or we are out of the auto-regulation now.
Blood flow will decrease.
Yes. And if you go out of the auto-regulation upwards then?
Blood flow will increase.
Yes. So that is known as pressure passive. That is given the term that the cerebral blood flow has now become pressure passive. That means the cerebral blood flow is now become directly dependent on the blood pressure of the patient. So if I go out of the range of autoregulation, if my patient's mean BP goes out of the range of autoregulation, then it will be directly proportional. So if my patient goes into severe hypotension, mean arterial BP almost 40, which is very low, that means even the blood flow to the brain will decrease. If the mean arterial BP has become very high, severe hypertension, 160, 170, the blood flow will also increase simultaneously. Because now this protective, we are out of this protective autoregulation range.
Ma'am, if BP is high, there will be vasoconstriction, no? Then how blood flow will increase?
That response of vasoconstriction and vasodilatation is applicable within this range. How do you think it's happening in this range? Within this range, that is that respective vasoconstriction or vasodilation will occur only within this range. Beyond this range, it is lost. That is why this autoregulation is so important. And it is very important for us to keep the BP of the patient within this range. Okay? So now we'll understand how this will come on the graph. Okay? So now this was our graph and we know that our BP ranges from 50 to 150. Yes. So BP, suppose we take over here now. Now we are taking MABP. Now we are referring to only MABP. Horizontal axis is MABP. Okay. I'm denoting with red color. So MABP from 50, what I told you from 50. So 50 is here, right? The point is here. Between MAP 50 to 150, autoregulation is there. So this is autoregulation. What does autoregulation mean? It will try to keep the flow fixed. No fluctuation in flow. Moment this is lost, flow will decrease. Moment this is beyond 150 range, flow will increase. And this is MABP. Confusion in the graph?
Hello.
This is the same if you draw three graphs. You draw three graphs and you put them on one on top of the other. This is what you get. Let's revise again. If my horizontal axis I am taking as CO2. My horizontal axis is denoting CO2. My vertical axis is denoting blood flow. I know CO2 range between 20 20 to 80, this is the range where I will be having direct proportionality with blood flow. If my blood flow, say PaCO2 decrease, my blood flow will decrease. If it is increasing, my blood flow will increase. Beyond this, no response. If I am taking this graph to be for oxygen, so horizontal axis, I will tell this is oxygen. Vertical axis is same, blood flow. And my blue line, okay? So CO2, we know below 60, oxygen, if it falls below 60, this is 60 mark over here. From 60 mark, it has come less, blood flow increased. Cerebral blood flow has increased, correct? From 50, it has increased up. Now, same graph I'm using for BP. So, this is now, I will tell, x-axis is BP and red line is BP. Now, red line is BP. So, I know BP regulation is between 50 to 150. Blood flow will remain fixed. Yes. Blood flow will remain fixed for auto-regulation, right? No fluctuation in blood flow, cerebral blood flow. So, between 50 and 150 range, this range, cerebral blood flow will remain constant due to auto-regulation property. The moment I exceed this value, it will become pressure passive and direct proportionally it will increase. As the BP is increasing, the blood flow is also increasing over cerebral blood flow. Pressure passive below 50. As my pressure has gone below 50, pressure passive, as my BP is falling, blood flow is also decreasing. This is just three graphs superimposed in one graph. And our main crux over here is 50 ml cerebral blood flow. So any confusion in this?
No.
No? Okay. Now what you need to know, there are only a few things left. So one is, which is left is neurologic. Okay. So there are some extracranial sympathetic, parasympathetic pathways that which are not well defined, and the contribution is also not well understood in cerebral blood flow. So it's very minimal importance right now for cerebral blood flow, that for the neurologic part. Okay. Then there is something rheologic, which is affecting the cerebral blood flow. So rheologic means what? Blood viscosity. When you say the term rheologic factors, it means blood viscosity. So what they are saying, blood viscosity is going to affect the cerebral blood flow. Okay, so what is the most important factor which affects the blood viscosity, the thickness of the blood? Hematocrit?
Yes.
If your hematocrit is more, your blood is going to be very thick, right? It's going to be extremely viscous. Okay, so the normal hematocrit is how much? 35 to 55%? Correct? Mm-hmm. Now, if you tell me, ma'am, I can reduce the hematocrit and increase the blood flow, na? More viscosity means less blood, less perfusion capacity, less flow.
Mm.
Thicker it is, yes, the blood, the difficult it is for perfusion, right? Thinner the blood it is, the faster, better perfusion and movement of blood will occur. This point you understand? So if you come and tell me, ma'am, I will hemodilute the patient, I will decrease the hematocrit and I will increase the cerebral blood flow. Is that right?
No, but
you should not do that. You ideally should not do that. Okay, you should not hemodilute. If you want to increase the cerebral blood flow, you are trying to increase the cerebral perfusion, you want to increase the cerebral blood flow, don't try to dilute the blood. That's not a right way of doing things.
Mm.
Okay. Then, because what will happen is that, the patient who's having cerebral ischemia, suppose, a patient who's having cerebral ischemia, ischemia means what? Decreased perfusion. So you might feel tempted to do this thing. You might feel tempted. But by this, you will induce anemia. You will induce dilutional anemia to the patient, right? So don't do this. This is not the right way. Okay. Then there are other things. So there are some vasodilators and vasoconstrictors. Okay. Which are responsible, which can affect the cerebral blood flow. Okay. So just get this straight. So there are some vasodilators, like we know sodium nitroprusside is a vasodilator, nitroglycerin is a vasodilator, hydralazine. Okay, these are all vasodilators. If these vasodilators reach the cerebral circulation, they will cause cerebral vasodilation. Correct? They have to reach there first. Correct? Yes. These molecules of these drugs have to reach there, then it will cause cerebral vasodilation. Another. There are certain drugs which are like catecholamine, which act on catecholamine receptors, which act on the alpha receptors, alpha 1, alpha 2, beta receptors, dopamine receptors, right? So what they cause? They cause vasoconstriction, right? When it will cause? If it is able to access the cerebral circulation, correct? Correct. So this access to the cerebral circulation will occur when the blood-brain barrier is damaged. So if there's a patient with traumatic brain injury, then this patient will respond to these drugs. That means then this patient's cerebral circulation will respond to these drugs. But if there's a normal person whose blood-brain barrier is intact, it will not respond greatly. There is a table in Miller's. You can have a look at that. Just look at that table and you will clearly understand that when the blood-brain barrier is damaged, these drugs have an effect on the cerebral circulation. When the blood-brain barrier is intact, there's minimal to no effect.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So is this understood? It's mainly regarding the blood-brain barrier, intact or not intact. Okay?
Okay.
Now the effect of anesthetic drugs on the cerebral blood flow and cerebral metabolism. You guys tell me the answer. What do you expect in thiopentone? What will happen to the cerebral blood flow and cerebral metabolism?
Will decrease.
Correct. Propofol?
Decrease.
Etomidate.
Come on. Decrease.
Benzodiazepines like midazolam?
Decrease.
Correct. Ketamine?
Increase.
Correct. Opioids?
It's decrease.
Okay. So the thing with opioids is that it will decrease definitely, like fentanyl and all will decrease. But there are some opioids which cause histamine release. Okay, like morphine. Older opioids, the older generation ones, they have a capacity of causing histamine release. So if histamine release will occur, then there can be vasodilation and there could be increase in cerebral blood flow. Okay. Next, what about lignocaine has a membrane stabilizing potential. Don't we use it for membrane stabilizing property in a patient who is having arrhythmias?
Yes.
You all remember lignocaine has got membrane stabilizing property. So if you give lignocaine to a patient, his membrane stabilizing property, because of the membrane stabilizing property, there'll be decrease in the energy needed for maintaining the membrane integrity. So basically to maintain the cellular membranes, the overall energy requirement will be decreased because lignocaine has now come to help. The overall cerebral metabolic oxygen requirement also will decrease.
Okay.
All right. So if there's a patient and you want to even decrease the intracranial pressure of that patient at the time of intubation or some procedure, you can use 1.5 to 2 mg per kg lignocaine IV, Loxycard. This Loxycard will decrease the cerebral metabolic rate and therefore decrease the cerebral perfusion, therefore decrease the ICP because of its membrane stabilizing property. This point is understood of lignocaine, property of lignocaine?
Yes. But lignocaine will cause seizures, ma'am.
That is if you exceed the toxic dose. Am I exceeding the toxic dose? 1 mg per kg? 1.5, 2 mg per kg? Am I?
No.
So I can use it for its properties of membrane stabilization.
Okay.
Correct?
Yes.
Okay, now we come to relaxants. So if I'm using non-depolarizing relaxant, which means everything except choline, what will I expect if I'm using rocuronium, suppose, or vecuronium? Any effect will be seen?
No effect.
Do you know there are some relaxants which cause histamine release?
Pancuronium.
Yes, and pancuronium doesn't cause actually histamine release. It causes catecholamine release. Atracurium. And one of the very old relaxants. Yes, this
tubocurin.
Yes, DTC. Tubocurin. Okay. So, atracurium, mevacurium, tubocurin, these are responsible for histamine release. Okay, the tubocurin was a very old relaxant. So, it caused a lot of histamine release. So, therefore, in that, because of histamine release, ICP was increasing, perfusion was increasing, metabolism was increasing. because of that histamine release. But atracurium is significantly lesser than DTC. So if you give less dose, you give it slowly, you can prevent histamine release, and hence you will not find any significant changes in your cerebral perfusion. So you will not find any significant change in terms of cerebral vasodilation. Okay. Is that understood?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Then you have pancuronium. Pancuronium causes catecholamine release.
Okay.
Pancuronium is known for catecholamine release. Okay. So this catecholamine release can increase the pressures. All right.
And scholine, ma'am?
Yeah, so now we're coming to scholine, but before that, laudanosine is what?
Laudanosine is that metabolic product of atracurium.
Yes, so laudanosine we know has got some seizure potential in it.
Yes, in renal failure patients.
Yeah, but so far it's not documented in any of the patients as of now in humans. So far nothing has been, no studies have been able to prove nowhere a seizure has occurred because of laudanosine accumulation. So it is the theoretical risk. Okay. Now scholine. How much does the ICP increase with the scholine? 5 mmHg. With scholine intubation dose, the ICP will increase by 5 mmHg. Okay. Why does this ICP increase? Because scholine causes increase in the cerebral activity. Okay, there are certain muscle spindles which get activated, which increases the cerebral activity and therefore increasing the cerebral metabolism and therefore increasing the intracranial pressure. Okay. Now, big question. Patient in the ICU, head injury, should I use scholine? What do you feel? You want to use, you don't want to use?
No.
I will use scholine. Now, there was a study which was done in which 10 ICU patients were given scholine for intubation. All right. And they saw that these head injury patients, there was no change in the ICP noted with a scholine dose of 1 mg per kg. There was no change in ICP. So they are proving and they're telling that it is safe to use scholine in the ICU for patients with head injury. Why is this? Because head injury... Head injury, which means what? Those impulses which are going to the brain, okay, which was causing the increase in the cerebral activity is not happening now because the brain is injured.
Okay.
An injured brain will not have cerebral activity, right? It won't increase. The inputs only will not go.
Okay.
So the method, the mechanism by which scholine is causing increase in the activity, the cerebral activity, that is only blunted. The response is blunted of the traumatic brain. So the brain will not respond to that. So therefore, scholine is safe.
The 5 mmHg you said, na, that is intubating dose, na, then it is...
That is increase in the intracranial pressure. So the intracranial pressure is 12. So for normal patient, from 12, it will go to plus 5, 17.
No, ma'am. Dose, you said the intubating dose, it's 1.5 to 2, no?
Yeah. But in the ICU, in that study, I'm talking about
that study. You are saying it's 1 mg per kg.
Yeah. They have used 1 mg per kg in that study. Okay. And in that study, they have concluded that it is safe to use this dose, 1 mg per kg in the ICU patients.
Okay.
Who have traumatic brain injury. So your cerebral physiology is over.